Hello and welcome to the Retro Hour, episode number 8, your weekly podcast covering retro gaming and technology news. I'm Dan Wood.
I'm Robbie Abbott.
And I'm Joe Fox.
Joe joins us again.
Yeah, no, thanks for having me once again. I'm glad to be back.
Yeah, Joe was on about a month ago now, was it?
Yeah, about a month ago, episode 3.
Yeah, we couldn't keep him away.
Yeah, exactly. I had to, had to get on the show again, dying for more.
Now, not only have we got Joe as a guest this week, who else is coming up in about half an hour from now then, Ravi?
We've got Anthony and Nicola Caulfield from Bedrooms to Billions.
Now, if you didn't see this documentary, it came out probably about 2 years ago now, was it? 2014?
Yeah, it's available on Netflix. It's a really, really well-made documentary, you know. Really high standard.
It's quite in depth as well. It's about 2 hours long. It's mainly about a British gaming.
Yeah, the kind of the bedrooms, basically bedrooms coders go into the billions and becoming international successes.
And right now they're actually working on they're making a movie that's a spin-off of that, all about the Amiga, like another 2 hour film.
Yeah, so. And this one's gonna be absolutely massive. This is probably gonna drive the Amiga community because it's telling the full story that everyone's missed out on.
Well, I remember these guys were even on like BBC TV Breakfast and stuff, like the last documentary.
Oh, yeah. No, they're very, very good at promotion and it's very high quality. So this is going to be, you know, all over the news. People will be going, what is this Amiga computer?
And we got the scoop.
Yeah.
So they're on in about 40 minutes from now. Now, while we're talking about the Amiga, obviously we had some very sad news over the weekend at the time of recording this.
Yeah. Dave Needle has passed away. And he was the kind of hardware man.
Well, Dave was one of the original guys with like RJ Michael and Carl Sassenrath, who right at the beginning of the Amiga, before Commodore even bought it. And then after that, he went on to work on the Atari Lynx and the 3DO. And you're a Lynx fan, aren't you, Joe?
Yeah, no, I was only on my Lynx the other day. I was getting all my stuff out of the attic and found the old Lynx. I was on Kung Fu?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, classic there.
But even like, you know, the Amiga obviously is a legendary machine. The 3DO as well, which a lot of people think was a bit of a full start, probably just wrong place, wrong time, but it is impressive.
It was still very cutting-edge machines, all of those were. And if you watch the videos of the history of Amiga, he's got such a personality. He's really, really a nice guy.
Now, we attended a few of the Amiga 30 shows last year. Unfortunately, we didn't go to any that Dave was at. He was only at the one in America, I think, wasn't he?
Yeah,
California.
Yeah.
And quite guttingly, he agreed to come on our show, didn't he, in the next couple of months, so... Unfortunately, that's never going to happen, sadly.
That's a shame, yeah.
But we've got this little video here. Now, this is from our friend Remotely Interested, who does a podcast, very good podcast. And this is a little message that he recorded, that Dave recorded last year for the Amiga's 30. So this gives you a little bit of an insight into his kind of personality and his charm, I think, this video.
Yeah, and it's kind of nice that, you know, he can celebrate it 30 years on.
Let's have a listen.
This is Amiga. This was 30 years ago. This was astonishing in its day, and it is still spectacular today. 7 megahertz clock, great sound, preemptive multitasking, incredible video, ease of programming, ease of use. I love it. I just love it. And this is serial number 1. It's 30 years old. It still works just fine.
So sincere. You can really tell how passionate he was about his creation and how much he loved it. Just from listening to that short clip there, it really shined through that he was quite down to earth and really proud of what he'd made as well.
Everyone says that about him. You know, everyone who's met him, and they all say he's so humble about his achievements. When you think a guy like that, that's not just worked on one big project, but he's gone on to
having a look here, like just looking at his Wikipedia page, and there's quite a lot on there. He's worked on quite a few notable systems.
But his spirit lives on every time you play your Amiga, your 3DO or your Lynx.
Yep.
Rest in peace, Dave.
Rest in peace.
Right, next one. Who are we?
We've kind of realised that we've done a podcast and very arrogantly assumed that you'd know who we are. And we've been getting questions and stuff like, oh, Dan has a really nice radio voice. So do you want to explain, Dan?
Well, we did get a little shout last week, as we mentioned, on the Retro Asylum podcast. And we've had a few new listeners since then who might not be familiar. Now, I've done a YouTube channel for, about 8 years, I think I've done my channel for now. Got about maybe 12,000 subscribers on there now. Done a lot of kind of, you know, not just Amiga stuff, but there is a lot of Amiga stuff on there, kind of covering, you know, retro gaming and technology, really, pretty much like this podcast. Also worked in professional broadcasting for about 15 years maybe now.
Yeah.
I feel old. Not that you know it, but yeah.
you were a DJ as well, weren't
yeah,
you?
Club yeah. DJ, websites, got all sorts, yeah. So, but yeah, I think, you know, there are a lot of people. I did see a comment on one of our videos the other day going, oh, I didn't realise you were the guy from the YouTube channel. I've subbed for years. So, yeah, like you said, arrogantly assumed the kind yeah. of, you know, he was just our audience. But
That's how kind of me and Dan met, because I was making videos of Amiga shows since kind of, you know, 2000 or 99. And then I saw this guy on YouTube and I was like, what? There's another person making Amiga? So,
and it turned out we live around the corner from each other.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, not stalkerish at all.
Yeah, yeah, we actually moved to this, yeah, yeah. Right around the corner.
He moved to where we live.
And I actually used to DJ as well, so we have a shared kind of passion of
well,
that.
Joe right? was in a band.
So oh, yeah, in a band, I was going to say, so. I've never been a DJ, but I've been in several bands over the years. Nothing successful, so I won't plug anything.
What kind of music was it? It was quite...
It was heavier stuff, yeah, you know, yeah. Your rocky, your metal, your... bit of death metal,
yeah.
But I was in a couple of bands in my youth, but yeah, no, I'm just friends of Ravi and Dan, and kick Dan's ass quite a lot of games, bit of gaming fanatic.
This is true,
so
this is true.
They asked me to come along, and here I am. So I don't have as an interesting job as these two, but
I'm a nerdy sound engineer, by the way. So yeah, yeah. I mix metal bands.
For a match made in heaven. Yeah. So there you go. That's who we are for the uninitiated. Right, should we crack on with this week's news stories?
Yep.
Now, this is quite an interesting one. We're going to do Brick the iPhone Unix story first today, I think, because this is something you challenged me to try and there's no chance I'm going to do it.
That's it. I don't know if you've heard of this, Joe.
What's this? So,
you've got an iPhone, haven't you, Joe?
I've got an iPhone. Of course I have. Everybody's got an iPhone. Yeah, of
so,
course I have.
The date that Unix, the operating system that iOS is based on,
yeah,
came out was in 1970s.
Get out.
And this is the 1st of January 1970, if you set your iPhone to that.
Yeah.
It's pre-Unix.
Yeah.
So it doesn't get it and it just bricks the whole phone.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So, yeah, essentially, I think the way Unix time works is it counts time from a fixed point. So to figure out what the current date is, it counts like the minutes and the seconds from the 1st of January 1970.
Yeah.
So if you set your phone to that, yeah, the iPhone, it completely bricks it. You can't do a firmware restore,
oh, really?
Anything, yeah. But kids have been going into Apple stores all over the world and doing this.
Doing
yeah, you know what I mean? iPads, it affects as well,
that's
any
brilliant.
iOS device.
It's
so.
Amazing how something that you don't think of at all, like Unix, the underlying mm-hmm. system, or, you know, Y2K bug or whatever,
yeah,
it kind of, something set in something, yeah. You know, it's
that's quite funny. No, I didn't know that at all. And I have before, you know, just being bored going through my phone. So, you know, it goes back to 1970, but
January 2nd,
yeah, it's just, yeah, just going back on the calendar, just like how far will this go? Just scrolling through it, but no, it's a good job I didn't set it.
But it's like, there is also, you know, you mentioned the Y2K thing there. Unix does have its own Y2K, but it's in 2038.
Okay,
it's going to hit.
There's an Amiga one, isn't there?
I think that's later. It's like 2077, I think.
if there be any running by then.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, you've got a few years till I'm sure they'll figure out a way around it. But in the meantime, do not set your iPhone date to the 1st of January 1970.
This is an official warning.
an official warning. Now, speaking of that, actually, this is quite a little interesting point you put on here, Ravi. What was your first Apple experience?
Yeah, this is due to us not mentioning Apple at all in the podcast so far. I
really want to say, like, something really cool and retro, like, oh, yeah, I played one of the Apple, you know, computers or something. I really didn't. It was iPhone.
Yeah.
Later on.
Yeah, So I think my first experience was just seeing the colourful, you know, the old colourful computers on TV.
Those iMacs that were all like yeah. Bondi Blue and all that.
Yeah. The one on Zoolander when they're trying to get in it.
This is all due to me watching Steve Jobs, actually. Oh, Danny Boyle's new
I
one.
I haven't
yeah.
watched that yet.
Is that any good?
Really good.
Oh,
yeah,
it?
Yeah. Recommend it out of all
there
of
go.
The
it's official
Steve
again.
Jobs films.
Well, it was the one last year with Ashton Kutcher, which...
Oh, God.
I thought it was a joke. I didn't think that was real. I knew about the Michael Fassbender one coming out.
Yeah.
And then I kept on seeing all these pictures of Ashton Kutcher. And I was like, is this some sort of like, what is this?
Like a skit or something.
Is this some sort of skit? Like, and then I just heard terrible, like, you know, I don't want to badmouth it, but I just didn't hear.
Oh, it was crap.
Yeah, there we go. Okay,
well,
we
this
go.
Has up to the kind of iMac-y period
yeah.
as well. So it's focused on all the launches.
Yeah.
So I'll have, you know, Macintosh launch, Next mm-hmm. Cube launch.
But yeah. even in the Ashton Kutcher one last year, I remember, you know, Steve Wozniak, who co-founded Apple with Steve Jobs, in the, you know, in real life, was the proper hardcore computer nerd.
Yeah.
Jobs was a businessman.
Yeah.
But in this film, the Ashton Kutcher one, it's Jobs who's trying to convince Woz that computers are worthwhile and stuff.
Woz is.
Yeah, it's like
made him out to be some proper like computer nerd.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like, which he wasn't at all, and it's like, but apparently this one's a bit more factual, you know, factual than the last film. So,
what was your first Mac experience, Dan?
My first time I ever saw Mac was in the school summer holidays. I was probably only about 8 years old, maybe. I went to stay with my auntie for a couple of weeks, and she ran a print shop. Yeah. If you had a Pronto print, I don't know if they're still around, they're like, nah.
Yeah, I think I've...
I think they're just like a franchise. She ran one of these in like late 80s, early 90s. But at the time, I had like a Commodore, you know, plus four at home that was just typing basic and stuff. And I went there and she had like three of them in a print shop. And I'd never used a computer mouse before. And I was like, what's this thing here? And I was like, she had the paint program up. And I think it was one of the old black and white Macs, you know, the all-in-ones.
Desktop publishing.
Yeah, it was DTP, yeah. And like, I'd never even used a mouse before, let alone, you know, she let me paint pictures on the screen because it was a print shop. They had a high-quality like laser printer. So I was making like, you know, Christmas cards and birthday cards from my friends. And,
blowing your mind.
Yeah, I was great. Like, but I always remember that. I mean, you know, I wasn't really I didn't get my first... I've also had Apple laptops, but I probably got my first one in about 2003, probably. It was an iBook G3. And I've always had Apple laptops since, and I've got a few desktops now as well. But yeah, it was probably a good, like, you know, 10 years between my first Mac experience. Then again, we used them at college. We had, I don't know if I told this story on the show last week. I've spoke to a few podcasts recently, not that I'm cheating on you. we had, when I was at college, you remember when, like, Napster and all that came out?
Yeah.
We had... We had this room that was like for the design students to use. But I go in there on a Saturday to use the internet and stuff. And then I figured out that I could download Napster onto all these Macs. So I basically had my own little botnet.
Brilliant.
Nice.
Macs. And they're on like a T1 connection, just downloading MP3s and burning them onto CDs after. So they figured me out after about 6 months, but I got an entire music collection.
I think I
sealed his DJ career.
I think I saw an old Mac, you know, Macintosh 2.
Oh, right, yeah.
Back in the days, and then went into a studio later on in the late kind of 90s, early 2000s, and they had one of these beautiful digital audio Macs.
All right.
Which was running Logic on.
So like a G4 or something?
Yeah, and it was SoundForge as well. Mm. And it was like a really beautiful machine.
When I went to college, and I think it was, I mean, it wasn't too long, it was like 2008, 2009, and it was all Mac, and I had been using Reason and stuff like to produce music terribly on my PC, and we went in and we had Logic and everything, and it was quite funny because this is probably my first main experiences with an iPhone, and they just assumed we'd all know how to use a Mac, and I barely knew what one was.
Yeah, you're like, there's one button.
Oh no, that blew my mind. I was like, how do I open another tab? For ages. Well,
the thing is about Apple, even now, I got like a new a Mac Mini i5 for my living room the other day, like about 2 weeks ago. But then they still set the mouse up to be one button, and you've got to go into the settings and change it. It's like, it can support two. Why not just have it on by default?
How are you finding the iWatch?
Yeah, well, I've got an Apple Watch as well. To be fair, I got this about a year ago. When did it come out? About a year ago, probably.
Yeah. About a year ago.
It's more just like, you know, text on your wrist, really. It's the novelty's kind of wore off a bit, but I don't really miss it if I haven't got it.
I've got one more thing as well, though. What does I read an article earlier this week. What does the I stand for?
Is it internet or interactive?
It's a bit of both. It was internet, interactive, inspire, I think.
Oh, okay.
There's a couple of things. I can't remember
information.
I think it was information, but it was, everybody always assumes it's internet, but it actually stands for about six things.
Yeah.
Which I thought was pretty cool.
Yeah, so. Just sounds cool, doesn't it?
Yeah. Like, inspire, information.
Because that's what they said about the iMac in the film. This is an internet machine, you know. It's just for the internet.
Well, did you guys get iPods back in the day?
Yeah, I had one,
Do you remember your first iPod?
Yeah, it was an iPod mini, so it wasn't that.
2005
ago.
Was it? Probably 10 years ago, though, were they?
Probably about 2006. Yeah.
I had a fat Creative Media Player. You know,
yours those, have to be alternative, really.
Yeah, these were pre-iPod. They were just literally a hard drive. Like, you know,
a ghetto blaster on your shoulder.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Groove Shark, I think. There was a thing called Groove Shark.
Yeah, I had a mini disc for a couple of years, and like, the iPod, I think, it was probably out around the same time, but it was like £400-£500 at first when it came out. And then I got one probably about 2002, maybe my first one. Ooh. It was the first iPod.
Yeah. I've seen your review on it.
Still got it, still works. Yeah, I've changed your battery in it since. But it was just, because the mini discs, I don't know if you've had mini discs, but you'd have to sit there and record them in real time.
Yeah, no, at college we had to use mini discs a lot for college radio and stuff, so...
Now I'm going to get nerdy. Do you remember data discs?
No. Were they mini discs that you could put data on? I never used them.
High capacity mini discs that you could do multi-track mixing.
It's very nerdy. Smile on his face.
Oh, they were so good.
Wasn't USB out by then, though, and no one gave a shit?
I think they did an MP3 compression thing, Sony Net MD.
Oh, yeah.
To ram as many tunes on a mini disc.
I think they were A-track format, though, weren't they?
Yeah.
It was A-track. You had to convert MP3 to what my mate had one, yeah. Yeah, rest in peace, mini disc. Yeah. I didn't like it, so there you go. We're a bit of Apple on the show, then.
Well, talking about that, we can actually skip to one story now,
which is
that cassettes are back. Mini disc isn't, but cassettes are.
You know, this is actually quite weird because I've been listening to cassettes quite a lot in the last couple of weeks. Over Christmas, I was back at my mum's and I got my cassette collection down. So, and they've been up there for about 15 years, probably. So I found all these old tapes again, and like the place I work, they were throwing out a proper studio Yamaha cassette recorder. Like just before Christmas, I was like, well, finally back up all those old tapes. So I've been one of these
You're
hipsters.
Riding the wave.
I know, mate, yeah.
You know what? Like, it's like all these other things, you know, vinyl making a comeback in the last couple of years and everything. But I have been expecting tapes to make a comeback because, you know, I think it was 2 years ago, you know, when Guardians of the Galaxy came out and it was like the kick-ass mix or whatever it was called, the awesome mix. And all of a sudden, everybody was using cassette tapes again. And I noticed this a lot at work, and a lot of friends and stuff were walking around with cassette tapes. And I was just like, oh, that's quite a novelty. And then all of a sudden it's, you know, in the paper.
I walked around Forest Fields the other day and I saw, this is an area in Nottingham, and I saw a tape wound around a lamppost. unraveled. And it really took me back.
Oh, wow. Yeah. You used to see that everywhere, didn't you? Yeah. I forgot about that. Yeah.
If it wasn't that, it was the shoes tied up around, you know, over the
power lines.
Well, that's where we're from.
I think with cassettes, it was like when you Walkman chewed it up, you took it out in frustration. We're like, oh, I'd throw it on the floor, didn't you?
And it would just like the wind would take it onto a lamppost or a fence, you know, yeah.
Now, I must admit, with my old tapes, though, I have been sampling them onto MP3 and throwing them in the bin. So I haven't actually got them anymore.
Pull them out the bin.
Yeah, I threw about 200 of them out. So if any cassette hipsters are listening, then...
Hipsters will be going for your trash.
Catch it before the bin man comes on Monday. Yeah. But it's like, I think cassettes did die for a reason.
Yeah. It's the digital world now. Like, analog's just...
But actually, I do remember in around 2001, when we're into the urban dance music scene, people couldn't afford to do mass CD production. So there was still tape packs coming out.
Well, I found tape packs of like, because I used to be into like UK Garage and like Ramsey and Fenn and the Dream Team, but you go into like record shops and you get these big like plastic boxes with like six tapes from a rave in. I've got a few of that, my mum still.
Worst quality.
Oh yeah, but it's like even then, they've been duplicated about 40 times. So, and with analog, the more you duplicate it, the worse quality it gets every time anyway. So yeah, I think, you know, I can see maybe a bit of nostalgia for old games and all that, but really... VHS tapes and cassette tapes, I think.
No, we
got rid of them for a reason.
I got all my, talking of VHS tapes, I got all my old gaming collection, a lot of nostalgic stuff out of my attic the other day. And I found the Street Fighter series, the cartoon, on VHS.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, oh my God, I can't play it on anything. But I took one of them out and it was just the tape just coming out.
Well, keeping on the music vibe, we can just look at this iam8bit.com, which is vinyl releases of game soundtracks.
So, see, vinyl is a different subject. You know, I quite like vinyl as well, but there is something... You know, vinyl's always been good quality. It's not like hissy,
cassette and video.
But this is like, you know, they've got the Battletoads soundtrack coming out, Banjo-Kazooie, Faster Than Light, XCOM, you know?
Yeah, Perfect Dark here as well. They're all pretty reasonably priced as well. Like, you can pay that much. You know, this is something quite unique, whereas you can go into a shop like HMV or something and spend more than what I can see here on the website on just... you know, kind of the new album or whatever, what's just come out kind of thing.
Yeah, they're always more than CDs, aren't they?
Yeah, so looking back here, this is really, looking at this website here, it's really unique.
And, you know, they've got some really good stuff like Hotline Miami, which is an absolute wicked soundtrack.
Wicked game, Nathan Drake
collection I see here as well.
Yeah.
But it's like, these are, you know, for the hardcore collectors really, aren't they? I imagine a lot of guys are going to frame these or whatever. You probably will never play them.
Yeah, you wouldn't get a DJ.
You're not going to sit back and really appreciate, you're not going to sit back and go, yeah, I'm going to listen to that 20 times. You'll listen to it once and then, like Dan says, put it on the shelf or put it in the frame.
Yeah, that's it.
Now, I thought this was quite interesting. Speaking of, like, you know, games being kind of art, as it were.
Yeah.
The story of the Amstrad CPC and Pixels.
Okay.
Now, have you seen these? They've done these like pixel books where there's pictures of games and stuff. They did one about the Commodore 64.
Oh, and it's like really zoomed in. And,
yeah, they look pretty cool. So there's one about Ocean Software, the ZX Spectrum story, one about US Gold they've done as well. So now, it hasn't been confirmed yet, but basically the guys behind this series is released a little teaser of a couple of pages of what looks like an Amstrad CPC collection. So,
Wow, that looks really nice. Yeah.
So I think the rest have been done on Kickstarter.
I can see it, yeah.
But these are, they're just nice if you're a fan of like any system having proper books with all the amazing game artwork and preserved and, you know, kind of presented in quite an artistic way. They're quite nice little coffee table books in that, I think.
It reminds me of Retro Gamer, actually. Their kind of presentation on there.
Yeah, the way they zoom them all in.
Yeah. Look, it's a really nice way of doing it, actually. I'm surprised they didn't do it in a lot of the old mags, but they were trying to keep the graphics looking really good, not pixely.
Yeah, the opposite now, isn't it?
Yeah.
I was going to say, these days we look at it and go, wow, look at the pixels on that.
Now, should we talk about the Coleco?
Oh, yes, let's go for
now,
it.
We'll just say off the straight away before we start on this, we've got someone telling us off last week for calling it the Coco Chameleon. We don't know why we said that. We know it's Coleco.
This is the unfolding saga of the Coleco. Do you want to
explain heard about this?
More?
Have you heard about this, Joe?
Yeah, the Coleco. Is that the one which is using all the Atari Jaguar consoles?
Now,
shells.
Yeah, we spoke about it. I mean, there is actually a video on Vimeo of the guy who's behind this. He goes to visit the company that bought the molds off Atari. Mm. And I don't think it's on YouTube, but we'll put a link to the Vimeo. It's quite interesting. You see him driving out there and he gets a tour of because it was, you know, a dental camera company.
Yeah, yeah.
Who bought the molds for the Atari Jaguar.
Yeah.
So you actually see this guy is the guy behind the dental stuff back in the late 90s. So he's got the original molds and he shows them all off. And the guy behind this Coleco project, he looks really excited about it. But this story's... it's kind of got a lot of twists and turns.
Definitely, because I'd come to present a story to you today about how they've got an Atari archive collection that they're going to be releasing on that. But then you told me something that's totally just blows that out of the water.
There's been a big thread on the Atari Age forum that's into like hundreds of pages now. And also there's been a few, there's a couple of videos on YouTube that's calling the whole project a scam.
Right.
Well, they were going to do it on Kickstarter, but they couldn't because they didn't have a prototype. And to do a Kickstarter, a hardware Kickstarter, you need a prototype.
Right.
So they made it an Indiegogo, and that failed, didn't it? It didn't reach its amount. So they went to Coleco, or the company that owned the Coleco trademark now. They were obviously like an early 80s console.
Yeah, ColecoVision.
Yeah, but I think it's just, you know, someone owns a trademark now. It's not the original company. But now they want to put it on Kickstarter again. However, to do that, they need obviously working prototype hardware. So last week, they're at a gaming show, I think it was a toy show actually in America, with what they said was a prototype of this new console.
Yeah.
However, it was only playing Super Nintendo games, and it was in the Atari Jaguar shell, but it had two Super Nintendo controllers just coming out the back of it, and it was covered in black duct tape,
right.
So you couldn't see where they were going. And the one in the control ports on the front, everyone's like, what are they, like, soldered directly onto the motherboard or something?
Yeah.
And then it turns out a few people at the show actually took a few pictures of it. And now, you know, I'll post a link to the forum if you want to see it in a bit more detail.
I know where this is going.
So, you look on the back and the AV connector is a Super Nintendo AV connector. You know that proprietary Nintendo one?
Yeah.
That the GameCube uses as well?
Yeah.
And also the power supply is one of those, it's like an all-in-one that does Genesis and SNES.
Right.
And one of the Genesis sides hanging off, so it's using the Super Nintendo power supply. The port layout is exactly the same.
Hmm.
And then the top of it, where the cart goes in, there is half of an Atari Jaguar cart. Around the back of it is a Super Nintendo EverDrive.
So they just disguised it shoddily, like not even that well by the sounds of things, just to fool and trick people that they've got a working prototype when they obviously don't.
That's what everyone's saying, yeah. I mean, by the looks of it, it's very suspicious, don't you think?
That's more than suspicious. That sounds like cold, hard evidence to me.
And the thing is, they seem to be absolutely spamming the news with news stuff recently.
All the mainstream sites are loving them.
Yeah. I've not been able to find news because there's been so much this talk about Coleco and then... Yeah. Yeah.
We had Gizmodo, an article from them last week, loving it. Engadget are all over it at the moment. But it's really YouTube and kind of the retro gaming forums where people are like, actually, no, this is...
And that's the CU podcast that did that little...
Yeah. There's a half an hour video, Pat the NES Punk, Dave, I can't remember his name.
Yeah.
Yeah, they did the CU podcast. And there's a half an hour video that they've done on YouTube.
Yeah, Punk Effect, guys, punkeffect.com.
Yeah, so I'll pop a link in our show notes if you're interested, but it's quite, it's an interesting story, but yeah. it does sound a bit shady, I've got to say.
I was going to say, it's kind of disappointing because I'm just looking at pictures of it now and the controller looks ace. Like, looks like it does look like a nice console. Like, mm-hmm. it's got that retro, you know, retro feel to it, but like aesthetically, it looks really new and Xbox One-ish.
And it's such a mix of completely everything. Last week we were discussing how it hasn't got a clear path.
We were saying last week, you know,
who's going to actually buy it? Like,
because you've got cartridges, but you haven't got any DLC, so there's going to be no exclusive games for it. All you're going to get is games that are on Steam and like Android.
And it's a Coleco console and an Atari case.
Could end up being, if it is real, could end up just being a bit of a Frankenstein's monster of consoles, really, and hardware.
Yeah. And even like, you know, we mentioned last week that if you're going to make it look like any console in history, would the Jaguar be the one that you pick?
Really? Yeah, you would have thought, you know, a Super Nintendo would be a little bit nicer or something.
Get rid of the Atari shell, just stick with the Super Nintendo. Yeah. You know what I mean? So what was it about the Atari archive, though? What have they got then?
They've just got a collection of Atari games that they're going to chuck on there. So 2,600 games. It's like, you know, your Steam Atari Vault that we covered the other day.
Is it just over 300 of them?
Yeah, so basically they've just got a load of titles that they can slap on there and say, oh, Atari fans, welcome.
Come buy it. Yeah.
This is going to be a cartridge gem, pretty much. You just, the game's only about 1K or something anyway, aren't they? Yeah. 2,600 games, but yeah, it's a project that obviously we'll keep following, but a bit of a skeptic about it. Yeah. Interesting story, though.
Good drama.
Yeah, well, it was a little bit of drama.
Yeah, a bit of popcorn.
Next story, Ravi.
Yes, we've got, as we talked to John Hare, the guy from Sensible Soccer, and he told us it was still going on. It is indeed. This is the World Cup of Sensible Soccer 2016 in Almelo, Netherlands.
On the 20th and 21st of August.
So, yeah, they do these every year, I think, don't they?
Yeah, and the mad thing is they get dedicated guys from all over Europe to come and actually stay over, like, compete, you know, stay for weeks, take it really seriously.
Why not? Yeah. That's what I say. If you're passionate about it and you enjoy it, why not?
And the tournament fee is, it's €120, it says, and that includes 3 nights stay with 8 meals. So, you know what I mean?
That's just like a little holiday, isn't it, really?
It's cheaper than a holiday, probably.
Well, yeah, exactly.
But Dan, you've not read the main thing, unlimited snacks and drinks.
Really? Yeah.
Maybe we should go.
It's going to get people out. Never even played Swass, about it.
Well, the terms and conditions are if you participate in all four tournaments there, Ravi.
Doesn't say for how long.
No, this is true.
But you know, this is still going on. It shows how much there's a demand for sociable soccer, and there's also a demand for old school Sensi still.
Yeah, well, we did mention when we had John Hare on the show the other week that he's working on a new football game at the moment, Sociable Soccer, which is kind of going to be the spiritual successor, isn't it, to Sensi? Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, there is still, you know, a committed fan base out there for it, absolutely. Now, there's a new Amiga game, footage being released.
Oh, I didn't know about this.
I'd not heard about this game before. Now, apparently last year in December, someone on one of the Amiga Facebook groups told us about this new Amiga game that's in development at the moment, and this looks like a cross between Chaos Engine and Gods.
I was just looking at it, and the first thing that came to mind was Chaos Engine. Like, that's what it looked like straight away.
Yeah,
to me,
very graphically the same, isn't it?
Which isn't a bad thing to look like.
Well, this is called Scourge of the Underkind.
This looks so good.
Yeah, well, it's he's released a video now showing the engine of it working, and this runs just on a standard Amiga 500. And if you look at it, I mean, the main character does look a bit like Gods, doesn't it?
You know what else it looks like? As we call it in the UK, zombies. Zombies Ain't My Neighbours.
Yeah.
It looks just really similar to that. A little bit slower, but maybe a little bit nicer as well, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, this does look like a full release. It doesn't look like, you know, a crap PD game or anything.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like,
no, this looks fantastic, this does.
Is he going to release this then?
Apparently so, yeah. This is just, I mean, I guess it's an early, I don't think there's any ETA for it yet, but he did announce it before Christmas, apparently. Now he's got this kind of, it looks like a fully workable engine, doesn't it, from the YouTube video? Mm.
This and Tanks Fury, I'm going to be Amiga gaming this year.
Exactly,
it looks great.
Yeah, exciting time. Yeah. Tell us about the Argos Arcade then, Ravi.
The Argos Arcade.
is this? Argos Arcade. This is a...
Well, our favourite thing is covering crappy new games consoles and of remakes.
Look at it.
And this is a tiny little arcade that Argos have made.
This looks cute.
For £24.99.
Save £5, free delivery.
240 classic games. Now, I don't know, they must be classic arcades. So you probably have some Atari stuff in there. You would have thought Neo Geo, or
they would have thought they might give you a list of the 240 games.
Yeah, this is Argos. Come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now this thing is called the Lexi Book Cyber Arcade. It turns out it's available on Amazon as well. Looking here. $24.99. Let's see if Amazon are any more detailed with the list.
Well, one thing that I'm going to say actually is now I've seen this on Argos. That's all the Argos stuff available. We're going to low off Argos because now we've got game, and the game store is Valhalla is absolutely full of all these weird retro, old school things. So there's the NES Retro Entertainment System, which is what they've actually released, which is a black NES.
So what's this? So game of, look at that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're selling all these kind of consoles now. So there's also
$22.99 as well.
There's also a list of the ones that they had out of stock. So
I'll just recap on this because we mentioned this in our first episode, I think, didn't we? That Game, the British high street game retailer, are now doing retro titles again. Mm. But they're actually selling consoles then, by the looks of it, aren't they? So they've got the Sega Mega Drive Classic.
You know what's just caught my eye? They've got a Neo Geo on here. Yeah, 134
gold limited edition,
which is an absolute steal for people in the UK. That is an absolute steal at £134.
Did they release this over here?
Well, this is a Neo Geo X.
Yeah,
which
it's a remake.
20 preload classic. So these are all remakes.
But they've got cartridge slots on them.
If you look at the out of stock one on the side, it says show. If you look at there, then you can see that they've got a Neo Legends 80s gaming table. They've got, like, you know, Sega classic packs. They've got Neo Geo arcade full-size cabs that they were selling through game, you know?
This is fantastic. I mean, this is really up my street. Anybody, definitely, if you were growing up in the 80s and 90s, this is something else. I'd definitely recommend getting onto the game website and looking at the retro section at the moment.
Now, we were going to talk about this actually a couple of weeks ago, and I forgot completely about it, but have any of you ever wanted to build your own arcade cabinet before?
Yeah, no, this is something I've discussed with friends of mine before. Making my own MAME cabinet, that would be pretty cool, but, you know, something I probably couldn't afford.
Have you seen a Hyperspin? That's what I've always wanted to do. So it's kind of a front end for arcade cabinets where you can have all the different systems on it, and bam, you just select it, it loads up the emulator straight away. Really nice presentation.
Yeah.
And
eight terabyte archive, apparently.
Oh, yeah. And you can, you can, every single game's on there. And you can, even have coin inserts on it. It'll work with jammer boards. So it'll work on the old arcade systems.
Is this for, you can install it on a PC then, can you, as well?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. It basically runs on the PC inside. But also, you can make custom menus. So people have done CD32 ones.
Okay.
Every system possible there.
Of course, before Christmas, my brother wanted, he was talking to me about getting a Super Nintendo he wanted.
Yeah.
I got like an old original Xbox.
Mm.
And I think it was, you know, That's Entertainment, the kind of, have you been in that shop before, That's Entertainment?
Yeah.
It's like HMV, but 10 years ago. And they got, they had original Xboxes for 20 quid.
Yeah.
So I bought one and I installed a thing called a CoinOps 7.
Okay.
All right.
Which is, it's a front end and it gives you not only pretty much all the Sega, Nintendo, Amiga, Atari, with loads of like games included.
Yeah.
But also, it's got MAME included as well.
Oh, nice.
I think there's about 4,000 arcade titles on it. And that was a big download. It was, I think, about 60 gigabytes. But I put a big hard disk in it, and you have to hack it, jailbreak the Xbox.
Yeah.
But that actually runs really well. But then I had a mate the week after who was talking to me. He wants to make an arcade cabinet. So I was saying, you know, should you use one of them? But a lot of people use Raspberry Pis as well. Mm. They're apparently quite good for it. So it's something I've always fancied doing, though.
I remember there was a guy, I'll try and add in the show notes, but there was a guy who made an Amiga cabinet on YouTube, and from the start, he made it using real Amiga hardware and hooked it up, and it's a whole series of videos. I'll try and find them and put them in the notes.
But I remember there used to be a podcast probably about late, maybe 2008, 2009, it was called System, it was on Revision 3,
mm-hmm.
and there's like about four episodes of that where they show you building an arcade cabinet from scratch, even cutting the wood out and how to paint it. And it's on YouTube, actually. So.
Yeah, and it's like a step-by-step, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
It's a lot cheaper to do your own than actually buy one pre-made. It's about £1,000, I think, if you buy them, aren't they, usually?
Yeah, and kind of, you can do custom backlights and yeah, you can get really nerdy, but imagine what your neighbours will think if you had an arcade cabinet, all those noises. And
yeah, I never leave the house. Yeah. But then it's, you wonder how many like old arcades have just got like cabinets sitting in the back that they haven't used for years.
Oh, yeah, you could probably go to an old pub or...
Yeah. Well, funny you should say that. My family are actually from Blackpool. So growing up, even just at my granddad's house, which was a B&B, he had an arcade room. Unfortunately, he sold a lot of them at a car boot a couple of years ago.
For about five or eight, probably.
Yeah, he had a sit-down classic Space Invaders glass table cabinet, and he sold it for 50 quid. And I could have broke down like on my knees crying when my mum told me that. But no, funny enough, if you lived in Blackpool, it probably wouldn't surprise you if you heard all these arcade sounds coming from you next
door. Well, you're giving us the tour of play Blackpool.
Yeah,
then.
That's a good point. I did think to myself when we're going next month after, isn't it?
So. Yeah. Yeah.
Right, a bit of Nintendo news then before we get into this week's interview.
Yeah, so the NX, which is the new Nintendo console. I know it's not retro, but, well, we'll talk about Nintendo.
It's sort of relevant, isn't it?
Yeah.
So,
they're a classic brand.
They've actually started sending stuff out to third-party developers. Now, this is mad, because they've not had third-party developers since the GameCube.
Oh, really?
Well, there was some on the Wii U, but everyone just, like, leaves after about 3 months usually, don't they?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because of Nintendo's crazy demands.
So EA are already reporting that they have a development unit from Nintendo.
Are they developing then?
I don't know, but, you know, at least the hardware's real.
there's rumours here that it's, you know, Final Fantasy as well, you know... There's rumours of that floating around.
Because that was the killer, wasn't it? When the PlayStation got Final Fantasy VII and they left Nintendo. That was the big...
So reading about that, it's a bit like, ooh, you know, partnerships coming back together.
Yeah, it's very interesting.
Rekindling old flames.
Let's finish off with one more Nintendo story then. This is old school. Have you seen this video about 101 gamers playing Super Mario Kart at the same time?
Yeah, I've seen that. It looks absolute madness. I didn't even realise. So is that actual players playing it?
This is actually an animation. It's
just
a mock-up. It's a guy on YouTube called Hat Loving Gamer. And he's put loads of characters from other games in as well. But you watch this video, they're doing the conga, pretty much are that close to each other.
They've got there's all sorts in there. We've got Kratos from God of War. We've got Pokemon in there and everything.
Crash Bandicoot.
We've got Golden Axe in there. So
even Sonic.
I was going to say, Dr. Robotnik's nice and prominent on the video there. But it looks fantastic piece of fantastic clip just looking at it.
It wouldn't be playable. We played it. We're like, what, four guys, didn't we, on the GameCube?
Oh, yeah.
Eight
of us, wasn't it, on Double Dash?
There was a really bad projection on the walls, so we could just see, bricks.
I was bitterly disappointed because I never lose at Double Dash, and I did.
imagine it with 101. Not going to work, is it?
Yeah, it's not going to work.
Right, well, thank you very much for listening to this week's show. Of course, you can get the Retro Hour every Friday from our website, theretrohour.com, on iTunes, YouTube, SoundCloud, all the usual places.
We're everywhere.
Can't get away, can't escape. And we're going to hand you over now to this week's interview now. If you watch the Bedrooms to Billions documentary, the creators of that, Anthony and Nicola Caulfield, also they're working on a new documentary now all about the Amiga. So we'll get the lowdown on that and we will catch you on next week's show. Welcome to the Retro Hour podcast.
Yes, and we are complete Amiga nutters, so we're looking forward to your film.
Let's start at the beginning, though. What's your background? What systems did you both grow up with?
For myself, it was the Commodore 64. I had that for many years, collected extensively for it, and right the way through the 80s, bought all the magazines, and probably like many other millions of children across the UK and across Europe. In the late 80s, my dad got an Atari ST-1040 with a black and white monochrome screen.
Nice.
Which, if anybody knows, you're not able to actually play many games with that, simply because it's the wrong hertz. So it was, I eventually was able to get hold of a colour monitor and start playing some games. And then after that, it was the Amiga A500 in 92, which I absolutely adored.
Yeah, I started with the Spectrum. And then from there, I had a Commodore as well. And then, around...
64.
Commodore 64.
Yeah, my 64.
Your 64, yes. Which I think that's why you married me, to get the Commodore 64 back.
Nice tactic.
And, and then from there, an Amiga as well. Although I loved having my Atari when I was younger as well.
2600.
My 2600. I absolutely adored that.
Why did the story of UK gaming need to be told?
I think it originally came because we were surprised that it hadn't been told before. We'd originally been trying to pitch it as a television series. We'd written the idea down in about 1999 in our notebook. We wrote a sort of several television series ideas. At that time, what happened to the British games industry?
Mm-hmm.
Simply because we were, when you are coming up with a documentary idea, normally what you do is you start it with a question. So, there has to be some form of question in order to explore the answer through the documentary. And we just did a little bit of looking around. And then, I think in 99, actually, we just watched Thumb Candy, the Ian Lee, very good documentary. We've met Ian a few times, actually, since then. And I think he was a little bit knocked that never made a series. It sort of, we bundled it around in the early 2000s.
And we kept changing how we should do it.
It was a one-off, then a three-parter, and we were trying to make sure it stayed, because Thumb Candy did a good job of, really doing a sort of quick 60-minute potted history of the games industry. They did a pretty good job, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. We sort of wanted to expand on that a bit and stick to the British games industry. And then we couldn't get any interest from any of the broadcasts, and we were beginning to find, occasionally showed a bit of annoyance about this over the years, and you sort of have to accept that when you've got commissioning editors, they're not experts in everything that you take it to. But we were finding a real resistance about doing anything about the games industry of any kind. It seemed to be a sort of slightly sneery attitude, looking down on it as if it was just not worth considering. And we were finding at the time that there was ridiculously large numbers of music documentaries and art documentaries and all sorts of different types, but nothing, zero, on the games industry. And when BBC4 started up in the, probably get the date slightly wrong, say 2006, 2007, and we started to notice that there was more sort of thinking man's type program, things that you might consider more niche.
Mm.
We went to BBC4 with what we thought was a really good idea, a three-parter, Ian Lee presenting it. We've had several chats with Ian about that at the time, and he was really up for it. And we even started sort of putting together the episodes, and we really convinced that it was going to get picked up. And we got a really good response from the commissioning editor at BBC4. And at that time, they just commissioned the Martin Freeman, Clive Sinclair, Acorn,
the Micro Men
War. Yeah, they just commissioned it. It hadn't been written yet at that time, and they asked us would we be interested in doing the documentary so that it actually coincided with the screening of that. So it would be, what would happen was you get Micro Men, and then the first episode of, and it wasn't called From Bedrooms to Billions then, it was a working title simply of British Video Games Documentary, very catchy. And we went several meetings up there, and we literally just got an email out of the blue after a couple of weeks just saying the controller of BBC4 feels that video games are too niche.
What?
For BBC4 viewers.
Wow.
Which it's a funny line. Nicola was I'd sort of be sort of like shaking my fist at the sky, and Nicola would always be fine, they're wasting their time, let's just go on.
The thing is, we're always looking for just a means of getting the idea out there, and really it was always film was where we always wanted to be, that's where a lot of our experience is. And so it was like going to TV was a means to try and find funding.
Yeah.
And when that kind of didn't work out, then we started to turn towards other options to get the funding and go the film route. And that's when we discovered crowdfunding. And the nice thing about crowdfunding is, you put your idea up there, it stays as your idea, and people buy into what they want you to do.
Looking at some of the guests that you had on Bedrooms to Billions, obviously a lot of these guys, the premise of the documentary is that it went from kids making games in their bedrooms to becoming like billionaires pretty much. But a lot of those were very, very young at the time. Guys like Matthew Smith, for example, who was coding Spectrum games from his bedroom before he was even a teenager. When speaking to these people, did you find that any of them kind of felt like they were taken advantage of and they didn't really understand the business all that well when they were so young?
That did happen. It's actually, in business, it's actually quite rare to get a creative that can create their own thing and be good at selling it. It doesn't tend to come. Usually, you find you've got to team the creative up with the salesman. You know, you tend to find that you have to sort of that. It doesn't always come that way. So when you do get a developer, a self coder, a bedroom coder that can actually also sell their own product and they've got the gift of the gab, then that is a rare thing. And you tend to find that those guys have done very well. And that doesn't mean they're better. It just means they have another a quality, a different talent to somebody else. So it means they might have had the extra thing. Or so there were plenty of developers that didn't have the business sense, but they were lucky to meet somebody that was, and they formed a good, solid team.
It's a bit like being a pop star when you're a kid, I guess, isn't it? You know what I mean? It must be a lot on your shoulders all of a sudden, and you're like, where's this come from?
Yeah, Matthew Smith himself, he got a lot of money very quickly, and then suddenly a lot of people came out of the woodwork and started getting money and treating him really well, and suddenly he was the centre of attention, and then he was on TV, and it was all fantastic. And then suddenly the pressure is there for the next game. And his way of dealing with the pressure, certainly for Jet Set Willy, is ultimately what undid him. I mean, there was, I don't know if you know, but we actually did release the making of Jet Set Willy last year. Mm. We showed it, we did a digital release of it to our backers. They all saw it. And we were sort of tentative about releasing that because Jet Set Willy's where it was the most painful memories for him. Mm-hmm. It was very, very difficult for him to talk about. There was a lot of pausing of the camera, if you know what I mean, and a lot of broken sentences where we had to, because that's where it really started to go wrong for him. So it was quite a hard part of the interview. So putting together, we were getting continually asked, oh, please release a Jet Set Willy making of, because we've got, you just wouldn't believe the number of making ofs that we could put out. They just take time to put together, you know. It's that one in particular was very hard to put together. But it's good. It came out. Nick did a great job on it, actually.
I remember meeting Matthew Smith when he'd first kind of come out of hiding and just started talking about Jet Set Willy, and it was very kind of a hard thing for him to do.
You know? Yeah, it is. It's
have to say that it was one of the best days we had, because we spent the entire day with him and Paul Drury.
Yeah,
and it was so nice, and he's so lovely. I mean, it's obviously hard for him to talk about everything, but it was, I'd say, one of the best interviews, because he hadn't really spoken about anything like that for years, had he?
He turned down, I know for a fact that he turned down some major television programmes, a Channel 4 programme in particular he turned down, and he accepted us. And it was really, we owe that to Paul. But it took a year to get the Matthew Smith interview. We were on it from like January 2012 to December 2012. When we were talking with him prior to the interview, Paul wanted us to find somewhere that he'd feel relaxed. So I said, well, where's somewhere that he's got the happiest memories? And he said, oh, the arcade that he used to visit as a kid. And then when I checked, found it's still open. And I called them up and said, look, we'd like to, and stupidly, because you're in the middle of the film production, you sort of think that everybody's heard of everybody you're interviewing, you know, as if they're megastars. And I called him up and said, we want to bring Matthew Smith down for an interview, and we wonder if it's possible we could just have an hour or two in the corner of the arcade. Anyway, the guy shuts the arcade for the day, well, not for the day, for half a day, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And he was like, whatever you need, no problem. You know, as long as you mention the name of the arcade in the film, can't wait to see it. Really looking forward to it. When we got there, he thought he was going to meet Doctor Who.
That's exactly what I thought you were going to say.
Why did you think the Amiga needs its own movie then?
When we were making From Bedrooms to Billions, when we had a lot of set questions. And when we got to the 16-bit era, it was getting very, very hard to find a developer that didn't trash the ST. And I had an ST, and I loved it. Yeah. And I was genuinely trying to understand why it was derided so much, because I thought it was, wasn't it popular? And it seemed to be, you know, developer after developer after developer was felt that what they really wanted to do was work with the Amiga, and they were held back by the ST. I had an ST for years, loved it. Then I got an Amiga, loved it equally. And I loved them equally. I didn't actually, as a consumer, rather than a technical genius, I just assumed they were both on equal footing, and the arguments about which one was best was just the type of silly playground wars that you used to get with the Spectrum and the Commodore, and that they both had their merits and everything else. So we were genuinely getting surprised when we were finding out from, you know, lots of developers and artists and other things. There was the odd developer that would say, oh, the ST was all right, it wasn't too bad. So we started to ask more questions about the difference between the machines, then began to realise that we wouldn't be able to really do this justice. We felt that the Amiga seemed to have been the driving force for everything. So it seemed to be that the... I can imagine a hell of a lot of ST fans pulling a hair out of this, but what it seemed to be was that even the development of the Amiga eventually saw the creation of the ST. Mm-hmm. It's rather complex, but it felt like the Amiga itself, with its multimedia capabilities and its graphical abilities and all the other things, was the actual injection into the... When I say computer industry, I mean it in relation to the games industry, what it did to the games industry. As how it suddenly the bar went right up in games. And obviously the ST does play a part of that. And the ST is not getting a trashing in the film, because the ST also played a part in how the Amiga, for example, the A500, then, you know, there were things that Tramiel was extremely good at getting product out there. It didn't matter whether it was good or bad, and generally it was good. But he was very, very good at selling and getting machines out there. And you sort of look at it and think, my God, if Tramiel had actually had the Amiga, you know, and there was no, you know, it was just the Amiga, then it would have just been, it would have dominated everything. Because mm-hmm. it should have effectively been a major force by the time we got to the real rise of the PC in the early 90s.
We did start cutting together that section in the film and thinking, there's so much to tell. That it just would have, we'd have had to have gone on for another 2 hours in that direction, and we just couldn't do it. And it to have, you know, we couldn't have skirted around stuff too much. There is just a whole, so much information. You know, when we've done our interviews for the Amiga years, there's stuff that we've only just found out ourselves as well. And you think, oh my God, how, there's just a huge story there, and it just would not have been able to get it all in from bedrooms. So that's why we decided at that point, we thought, well, we can only really cover, I think it's about 20 minutes in the film, something like that. Mm. We just couldn't go into detail on it.
I will say one thing, as someone who grew up with an Amiga, I mean, you know, you mentioned that you both had Amiga 500s as well. I don't know if you touch on this in the film at all, but piracy was a massive thing on the Amiga. Is that anything that you mentioned in the film?
It's a really big one, that. You've got arguments that it was a good thing, arguments that it was a bad thing, but, you know, if you're a developer and you receive a paltry royalty for a game that you've worked 18 months on, and you're relying on your mortgage being paid, and just living, and you can't make new games because you don't get any royalties in because millions of copies have been pirated, then it's not funny. You know, it's a serious business for you. You know, you want to make, if you get good royalties in, fine, you might buy a Ferrari, but at the end of the day, you're going to make more games, and you're going to be happier as a creative developer and wanting to make more games. But on the flip side, you had the whole demo scene, which was fueled by the copying, the copy parties and other things. And the Amiga made that very, very simple.
Xcopy was a system seller.
Yes, we've actually interviewed Rich Aplin, who... as he said, he had played a part in that. He didn't solely develop Xcopy, but he was involved in some of the work on it. And as he said, he provides copying assistance software.
Well, at the current moment, a lot of the top cracking groups and hacking groups that release torrents often talk about Amiga, and a lot of them are actually groups from the Amiga, so it's still kind of got a Pirate Bay legacy.
I think it's quite funny that, because when it's like when From Bedrooms to Billions came out, we released it to backers. And by the way, I'm not saying this because we're annoyed, because if anything, we're flattered. But having said everything about Pirate, but literally, I checked the torrent sites within about 3 hours of we released the film digitally to only to backers. It didn't come out for about another 48 hours. And it was on a torrent site within 3 hours. Oh, and I thought, a backer must have encoded that and stuck it up. And I thought, fair enough. Well, I expected that. I thought, well, and it was just... But then somebody told me it had gone to number one in some... I can't... Some popcorn thing or something it's called. A very, very popular torrent chart. and it went to number one. It was like within a couple of days. So we were sort of, oh, okay.
We also found it on YouTube as well.
Oh, yeah, some idiot stuck it on YouTube within a few days. I was like, well, so I have to take that down. But I have to be, it's funny, actually, we've had not hate mail, but we've had some really weird emails from ST groups. It's a bit like, I think it's a bit like the little brother syndrome, where the sort of, you know, the little brother that's, has to shout slightly louder to be heard by the older brothers and sisters. I think the ST sort of users feel as if like we've sort of sold out or something going for the Amiga, but it's not, it's nothing like that. If we'd called it the ST and the Amiga years, it just, first of all, it's not the greatest title, though that yeah. was our working title for a little while. But we felt that the story of the Amiga is a really good one to tell. You know, there's an awful lot of great material to tell in telling the story. I mean, the whole, and the lineage of the Amiga is totally Atari.
Yeah.
It should have been the next, you know, you know this, obviously.
Yeah,
it should have been the next Atari machine.
Mm-hmm.
And also, as we were shooting all the interviews, we were learning that the effort that went into effectively create the chips, because what you got to understand is that when Jay Miner and Joe DeCore worked at Atari in 1976, the Stellar project, which became the VCS 2600, at the time, the arcade machines predominantly obviously in the US, which were using discrete logic before microprocessors were being used, you were talking about having 150, 200 chips on machines like Super Breakout, which that's all they could play. That's all they could play, and were extremely expensive to manufacture. So of course the Stellar team, the first task they had was trying to work out a way of shrinking 150 odd chips down to one, so that it could be mass produced and get into people's homes. So it was a way of trying to get complex games that people were enjoying in the arcades and bringing them home.
Mm-hmm.
And that became the first task. So you tend to find with engineers is it's all about solving problems. Same with coding. You know, you have a problem. I want to do this, or I want to shrink this number of chips down into this. So then there's just logical problems. And what I've got here sitting on my desk is Joe and Jay's, all their notes, all of them, handwritten notes, all of the originals, where they've solving all their problems to get effectively to create the chips for the Stellar. And then the same with the Atari 800. And then I've got there, funny enough, I posted this on the Amiga Facebook page today because I promised I'd give them some stuff. But the 1979 design document on Atari-headed paper for the Amiga.
No way. Was that posted today, was it?
Yeah, I saw it earlier.
But effectively, that would have been... So 1979, Joe and Jay, as far as I'm concerned, after successfully working on the VCS, come out, sold millions of units, Atari 800... It was a brilliant, brilliant machine, the 400 and 800. It didn't sell in the same sort of units as you would expect, like with the Apple II and certainly the Commodore 64 a couple of years later. Their next project, as far as they were concerned, was a 68,000 machine.
Mm-hmm.
That would be the next generation that might take a couple of years to develop. And they were just stonewalled by Atari at that time, who were owned by Warner Communications. So that was why they were immediately... And that's why Jay and Joe mm-hmm. ultimately left, because as engineers, you want to be working on the next groundbreaking project, not working on sort of the silly little telephones and stuff that they were asked to start working on.
Just one thing I'd like to ask you, because I think you guys might know, you know, having spoken to so many people, you might know better than anyone, but why do you think people are so interested in retro gaming and computers?
I was watching a YouTube gamer the other day that's 28 years old, right? And he was talking, you know, Frankie on PC in 1080p, he was talking about a retro game for him, which was Tomb Raider 2. And to him, that's retro gaming. He was playing Tomb Raider 2 and uploading the video onto YouTube. Now he plays sort of DayZ and all sorts of main PC games. But to him, as a 28-year-old, his retro gaming is the console that he had as a kid that he loved. It was his first console, and to him, it brought warm, lovely feeling back to him. Now, for me, when I play Bruce Lee, it reminds me of playing it in my bedroom as a 12-year-old, and really enjoying playing through the game and being amazed by the graphics and all the other things that came from it. So I think that...
It's that nostalgia, it's that feeling that it gives you of remembering what you were like when you were little. You know, I mean, when I sit there with my Spectrum, which doesn't work at the moment, but I sit there and I look at it and I think of my time in my mum and dad's front room, lying on the floor with my neck bent upwards trying to type stuff in and spending the entire day doing a typing listing and then it never working.
Never did, did
that. So there's things like that, and I think that's what it is. It's just that nostalgia.
And if it's a time when you're enjoying yourself, then it just reconnects those wires in your mind sometimes and brings back those floods of great memories. Whether it be, sometimes I've got a lot of my old games on display now. So, you know, I pull out the cassette and it's just like the idea of opening it, even the Mastertronic cassette. It's just this for the feeling of opening it up and looking at, and I might not have looked at that particular cassette properly, opened it up for 25 years, 30 years. And the same is with the Amiga. Because I remember being older when I got my A500 in 92. It was relatively late for me, but and same with the ST. It's that connection with the past. And one of the things that we tried to do with From Bedrooms to Billions was give the viewers a feeling of that nostalgia, so that they weren't just looking at talking heads. They were seeing things, hearing things, all the time. And one of the things that I personally take a lot of pleasure from is when people write to us and say that they love watching it over and over. And somebody actually posted once, I think about 6 months ago, they said it's a great film to have on with the sound low, with your mates. As if it's, like have a few friends around and put the film on. I'm not trying to sell it here,
just
by
get
the
atmosphere,
And literally it just comes to that thing where you see something on screen and then you have a conversation for 20 minutes because you saw a clip of a game that triggered and then you all have a chat about it. So I've noticed people have said it's a great social film where a few friends come around and you bung it on, even bits of it or something. Sometimes I actually fire it up on Netflix and watch the Commodore 64 bit, because it sounds really big-headed, this, but I just love listening to the SID chip sequence in it. I just enjoy that bit because I used to take a lot of pleasure from listening to Robin and Martin Galway back in the day. So I just like that sequence personally.
And we make our friends watch it, don't we?
Come on, watch my
again
film.
Well, Stuart Connolly, I collaborated with on a couple of tracks on the Home sound, on the From Bedrooms to Billions soundtrack. We worked on Home and a couple others. He's working with Rob Hubbard and myself again, and he's got a little studio in his flat. And sometimes I go over there, and after we've recorded or done something, it's gone on too many times. And Nicola actually said, "You didn't put From Bedrooms to Billions on again." And I said, "Well, it was only to sort of show them how that track was used in the film." And she's like, "I don't want to know. It's embarrassing. The guy's going to disown you. He's not going to want to know."
Well, there'll be obviously this new film that you can we can all watch over and over again, no doubt. When can we expect the Amiga years then?
I was going to say at the moment. No, yeah. It's coming out on the 28th of April. We've got some filming coming up in the next couple of weeks, but we've got a solid timeline together now, and we've got most of our archive together now.
Yeah, just getting music clearances sorted out. It's a bit more archive we're trying to source as well. So
I must also say, sorry to bring this up now, sort of, but we were actually really upset yesterday because obviously Dave Needle passed away.
Yeah,
we mentioned that at the beginning of our show, and I guess you guys met him for interviews for the Amiga years.
I filmed him and exchanged many emails with him, and he was a really, really lovely guy. Mm. And we were really upset on Sunday night when we read it. RJ let everybody know, and it was just, we were just gutted, basically. I don't think there's really much else we can really say about it. Just our thoughts go out to his family. I mean, he never really was able to get over the death of his wife. He was so upset about his wife, and even when we were filming, he had to take moments because he's very emotional, a very emotional guy, very lovely guy, but very emotional. And I think that's, again, as I posted earlier today, we genuinely take a crumb of comfort in the idea that he might now be with her again. So yeah. Moving slightly forward, what hopefully will encapsulate when we're telling that part of the story is how the Amiga was built was a true team effort where, people weren't being paid. And Dave was one of those where he worked for months and months with no money because he believed in the project.
His interview is brilliant, absolutely fantastic. And actually, we're actually working on a big section with him at the moment. So it'll be nice seeing that all in the film.
Genius. But he told us so many great stories. One in particular, he gave us permission to reveal, which we can't reveal on here, but it will be in the film.
Yeah.
It's quite a
What a tease.
Quite a big one. So it's the first time it's ever been revealed. So he said he assures us. Well, in fact, we told RJ, didn't we? And RJ said he knew it, but he was like, I can't believe Dave's gone and said that. There's a lot of stuff like that. And Bob Perisseau is a real sort of unheard of hero, really. We tried to get Bob in the film, but we couldn't. We found him, but we couldn't get a reply from him, which, you know, you get. When you're dealing with people's pasts, you know, Bob got fired, not by Jay or any of the direct Amiga team. It was Commodore management when they cleared house, mainly due to cash flow problems in the in sort of 86, 87, because, like, they didn't even go to CES in January 86. You think they've got this amazing new computer that could change the world, and they haven't released it properly yet. It's been announced. It's come out. They can barely afford to produce many units, and they can't even afford to go to the January CES show in Vegas in 86.
Commodore all over that, though, isn't it?
You know, it's
they all talk about Bob Perisseau, though. He was so good at selling.
Yeah.
And any kind of anything that presented itself, any hitches or anything, he was so good at adapting to them situations and kind of continuing to sell. No matter what was happening, he would continue to sell and show how good the computer was. So, yeah, there's a nice little section on Bob within the film as well.
Bob Perisseau is the guy with the ponytail and the tuxedo that comes out and says, you know...
the launch of the Amiga,
introduces the Amiga, yeah.
Yeah.
What can you do with the Amiga and everything? So, yeah, we were hoping to get him in the film, but we've not done bad. We've got most of the original engineering team in the film, plus a few surprises. We never like to reveal everybody. We like, you know, we are trying to entertain. So we want it to be a few moments. Oh, I didn't think you'd get him. Oh, they managed to get him. So there's hopefully a few moments like that.
Well, I've got to say, you know, Ravi and I are both massive Amiga fans. And, you know, I love the original Bedrooms to Billions, and I know Ravi did too. You know, when I heard there's going to be a dedicated movie, I was...
Yeah, I've got my Blu-ray ordered.
Cannot wait.
Thank
to
you
see
very
it.
Much.
Well, listen, guys, we could talk all night, honestly, but I know you've got little ones and our show's only an hour long. But it's been a pleasure talking to you both. Thank you so much for coming on.
Excellent.
Thank you for having
us.
When's the film out again?
28th of April. And you can pre-order it now. If you want the Oliver Frey cover, you have to pre-order it now from www.bedroomstobillions.com. Otherwise, after the 28th of April, it'll be another cover.
Oh, you need to get limited edition.
Yeah, we did it with From Bedrooms to Billions, if you remember. There's the Oliver Frey cover, which only backers have.
I think and I went for limited.
Yeah, and then you've got the Paul Carr one, which is the, you know, Tarantino's artist. We did our the black one with the which is actually our son, Thomas.
How is it?
With Matthew Smith's ZX Spectrum.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, we've revealed that before, have we?
Exclusive.
Brilliant. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Take care. Thank you very much.